the first verse here, verse 5. Put to death therefore, which again we talked about a couple weeks ago. When we see the word therefore, we immediately kind of have to look back. It sends us back in the text. So immediately we have to say, whatever we're about to read, whatever we're about to study or think about, is in direct relationship to whatever we just read. So last week we looked at verses 1 through 4. And essentially, we saw that Christ has died and he has risen, and in him we have died and have risen to a new reality, to a new paradigm, to a new kingdom, and a whole new set of values in response to this brand new reality that Christ has liberated for us. He has set us free from all the things that held us back, and now we're to set our minds and our hearts on the things above. Are we remembering this from last week? We're kind of in tune. So then Paul is going to suggest a whole slew of things today that can actually help us to live into the new reality, the new kingdom, the new values that he has set forth in his new kingdom. But we would only do any of that because Christ has set us free from the things of the earth. We have been liberated from the things of the earth. We focus our hearts and minds on the things from above. And now, in that mindset, we move forward in the text to do the things that Paul is instructing us to do, inviting us to do here this morning. So, let's continue. Verse 5. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Sexual immorality, impurity, lust, desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. We'll stop there just for a moment. So Paul begins this section essentially by telling us a whole bunch of things that we should not do, right? This is a list of things that we do not do. Essentially, he's arguing for an ethic of secession. We are choosing to secede from all sorts of ways, patterns, ethics, values that were of the old system. Now we are walking away from that old system and into something new. We are pulling away, we are withdrawing from the ways of the old age. And Paul does not mince words here, right? His first words are put to death. He's not messing around here. This is stark, strong language. We're in a battle. The values of the world are actually kind of just must have something. And we cannot be deterred from having that thing that we want. It's an overmastering passion, which isn't exactly the kind of behavior you want to be living in if you've been freed by Christ. If you've been set free from all the old patterns, lust doesn't seem like one of the characters of the new kingdom, where we can't even be, we're controlled by the things that are in our lives, by evil sorts of passions. Paul talks about evil desires. He's talking about self-gratification, having us do whatever we want to help ourselves, to assist ourselves, to bring enjoyment to ourselves, and not what's best for our spouses, our families, our kids, our churches, our entire community. We're choosing to do things that are best for us and only us. And then he finishes this little section by talking about the vice of greed, which seems kind of funny because everything that we talked about so far is kind of sexual in nature, right? Sexual immorality, lust, evil desires. And then he throws this word greed in here, but I think it fits. I think it fits the narrative. Greed is covetousness. It's never being content. It's always wanting more. It's never having enough. That's what greed is. It's always searching for more and better, and that most certainly would encapsulate sexual immorality and lust and evil desires. It's never enough. We always want more. We're never content with what we have, whether it's sexually speaking or in any category of our life. We always want more. We're greedy about all sorts of things, and it's most likely because we live in this kind of imperial culture that tells us that we should want more. Our culture tells us day in and day out that the best way to live is to get more and more and more. So, of course, greed is part of the imperial value, part of the world's set of ethics. Because this is all idolatrous, which I think is absolutely true. I think it's a completely accurate description. This isn't the way that we were meant to live. We weren't quite meant to live these kind of values, these kind of ethical standards. That's not the way we were intended. We were meant to leave father and mother, cleave to one another, and become one, and only one. We were meant to be content in all things, for God's provision to be enough for us, and for us to not always be wanting more. So these kinds of behaviors are absolutely idolatrous. They move us away from the way God originally intended the world to operate, from the way that he wanted humanity to behave. And any time that we're moving away from God's original design, we've slipped into idolatry. We're saying that I will find my own way. I will find my own path. I will set my own values, my own ethical standards, and they will be better than yours. So it's idolatrous in nature. Walsh and Keesmet said, the life-giving, fruit-bearing joy of creation is lost and killed by a consumptive, greedy, and idolatrous worldview that leaves our lives fundamentally barren. This way of life robs us of all life. There's no life to be found in those values. They produce death, and they rob us of all life. So, of course then, God is mad. Right? If you're following along in your Pew Bible, we've gotten to the passage where Paul says that because of these, the wrath of God is coming. Which sounds judgmental, and I don't even like kind of reading that verse. It sounds so mean. But of course God is mad. Of course God's wrath is coming. And again, as Walsh and Keesmet say, if this God did not respond to such a travesty, such a mockery of his good creation with wrath, we would wonder how deep his love really went. Wrath is the right response to screwing around with idols. That's harsh. I don't even like reading that sentence, but I think it works. God has this original idea intended, and it is good and beautiful and right, and then we choose all of these other values. We choose to keep slipping back into the imperial or worldly values or worldly things instead of walking forward into God's beautiful path for us. It just has to tick off, though. that it must make him angry. And then Paul continues his list of vices. He moves on. The things that must go away. Now he's changed the metaphor again. Now instead of dying to those things, he says we must get rid of those things. We must rid ourselves of this new list. And it really is a list of violence. It's a list of things that are violent. All the ways in which the violence of the empire has soaked into our bones. There's a million ways in which we are told violent things, we witness violent things all day, every day, and it seeps into who we are. And we begin to live out these things. So he's talking about anger, which is kind of the idea of this continuous state of smoldering or seething hatred. I mean, imagine a campfire that you put out, but it still continues to smolder. It's out. It's not there anymore. There's no flames in the moment, but it's still hot, and it's still smoldering. I think that's what anger is like. It kind of lives below the surface. And it doesn't necessarily always come out, but it's kind of this low-grade contempt that is just smoldering. And all it needs is a little oxygen to be fanned back into flame. And when that happens, that manifests itself in rage, which is the next item on our list. When this smoldering anger actually breaks out into deeds and words, when it comes alive again, when that life breathed into it, it turns into rage. Paul talks about malice, which is kind of first-degree rage. It's rage that's been planned, where we actually have evil in mind, and we actually want to hurt someone. I didn't just spout off with something off the cuff. I actually kind of thought about how it would make that person feel, and I wanted to hurt. I wanted to inflict damage with my words. That's malice. He talks about slander, which is when our malice becomes practical through the things we say. We put people down, we talk bad about people. The Greek word for slander is actually the word blasphemy, where we get blasphemy, right? Which makes sense to me. Slander is actually the dishonoring of God himself. It's actually less about the person we're slandering, and it's more about dishonoring God. When we revile, mock, tease, curse, defame, or backstab someone who was created by God, in God's image, and is loved deeply and dearly by God, we're actually inflicting wounds upon God. Or it's actually blasphemous when we slander that person, because they are loved and cherished by God in the universe. How dare we would slander somebody who God loves deeply and created in his image. Paul talks about filthy language, words that are foul and abusive, that contaminate both the speaker and the hearer. We're not just talking about cursing. We're not talking about saying dirty words. We're talking about words that come out and actually are filthy in nature, and they contaminate us, and they contaminate whoever they go into as well. And then maybe the worst sin of all on the list Paul talks about is lying. N.T. Wright says, truth is often inconvenient, untidy, and more embarrassing, and we are constantly tempted to bend it into a less awkward shape. Truth is hard. Truth has become challenging. Lying has become an epidemic in our world, and it most certainly needs to be put to death, rid from our system. And then Paul moves on in the text. He moves on to the next section. Verse 12, if you're following along. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. So this is a section now about what to do. We had a section about what not to do, and now we're talking about the things that we actually want to do. But again, like Paul does so often, he changes the metaphor on us. I appreciated the metaphor in the first section. I kind of appreciate the bluntness and the start thinking about clothing now at this point. We start thinking about clothing ourselves with all sorts of good behaviors, which makes me think of all sorts of things about clothing. Because we understand clothing really well in our culture. We know it well. Clothes often say so much about who we are. They give the world just a small glimpse, sometimes even a large glimpse, of what's on the inside, of what matters to us. Clothes say so much about who we are. They tell a story about how much money we have. Or don't they? They often tell a story about whether we're rich or poor, whether we have a good job or a not so good job, whether we work with our hands or we work with on a computer or in a cubicle. They tell a story to the world about our white collar or blue collar kind of people. They tell a story about how we spend our time. They tell the world something about what matters to us. Our clothing can actually reveal something of our identity. So this metaphor, then, cloak yourself, is an interesting one to help us think through what Paul's been talking about in Colossians. I think it's worth exploring. And then specifically what he's inviting us to here in our passage for today. So I want you to think back. If you have your Bibles on your lap, you can actually look back. But you can think back to chapter 2. And Paul uses this language. He says that Christ disarmed the powers and the authorities of the world through the cross. You remember this? We talked about this. We talked about the parade, right? Christ essentially puts the powers and authorities of the world on parade, shaming, shame, killing, death. He has disarmed the powers. This is the language that Paul uses. But I think the metaphor of clothe yourself actually works for that section too. Think about that. Think about that language, that thought through the clothing metaphor. I think Christ also disrobes the empire. He disarms the empire, but I think he also disrobes the empire. He shames them through the cross. He actually strips them down bare and parades them through town naked and ashamed. I think he strips them down. He disrobes the empire. He exposes the clothes of the empire for what they are. A way of violence and evil and death. He names all of the problems by stripping them down and burying them naked and revealing them to the entire world. But the sad part of that story is that we far too often actually wear the emperor's clothes as well. We're actually far too often dressed up like the empire. We wear what they wear and we look like they look like and we value what they value. So when Jesus tears the clothes off the empire and reveals it as fraudulent, when he exposes the empire and bears them as impotent, we are actually shown to be fraudulent in that moment as well. If we have aligned ourselves with the values of the empire, if we're wearing the emperor's clothes and Jesus strips them off and bears them to the world, then we're shown to be fraudulent in that moment as well, in desperate of a new set of clothes. Kingdom clothes. We need kingdom clothes instead of the world's clothes. So then, because Christ has freed us from the old age, from the earthly things, from the things of the world, from the way of the world, we're actually invited to strip off all the clothing of the empire that still holds us captive and hides our true identity. We're invited to put that old way of death. To not live that way for one more second. Call it put to death, call it rid yourself, but I'm saying that we're called to strip off the empire. All those old values, all that old ethical system, we're called to strip off ethical or sexual immorality. We're called to take that off. Any sort of improper or promiscuous kind of behavior that has strayed from the promise and the commitment of marriage, the way that God intended for the world to operate, that has no place in Jesus' new kingdom of morality and goodness and beauty and light. We're called to strip off sexual immorality. we need to strip ourselves of any sort of impure behavior because Christ has freed us, liberated us, and that way is the old way and must be put to death. We're called to strip off lust, whether sexually speaking or any sort of uncontrollable or insatiable passion, anything that controls us, that binds us, that weighs us down, where we're wearing this kind of clothing that we shouldn't be wearing, like wearing 18 coats in the middle of the summer while you're preaching a sermon. Anything that weighs us down and keeps us from living the kind of ethical life that Jesus has called us to, we strip that off. We're called to strip off evil desires, where our thinking is all about ourselves first and us getting what we want and not about us serving others and putting our family and our friends and our community and our neighbors and the poor and the oppressed first. Anything that is evil in nature and selfish in nature, we strip off. We're called to strip off greed. Jesus' way, God's way, is a way of contentment, where we find peace with what we have, with what God has provided for us, where God graciously provides for our needs, and we find contentment in God's provision. So we must get rid of any flows of jealousy, covetousness, where we don't feel content. Anytime I wish I were someone else, or where I hate who I am, or how I look, or how a loving creator who has fashioned us in his image and graciously provides for all of our needs. It's not good, and it must be stripped out of our lives for good. We need to strip ourselves of the violence of the empire. We need to rid ourselves of anything. All of these waves of violence that emerge from our words and from our actions, things like anger, it has to be gone. Which I will confess, in a moment of vulnerability, when I'm going through the list, that's the thing that most sticks in my gut. It's the thing that most bothers me. It's the most obvious and unhealthy piece of imperial clothing that I wear personally. It's anger. But we're called to strip off rage. We're called to strip off malice. Where we're intentionally trying to hurt people. We're called to strip off slander. We're called to strip off filthy language. Whatever the empire's clothing looks like for you, they must be stripped off. We have to be laid bare, and it's gonna shame you. I understand. This is weird. I understand that I feel ashamed right now. And I think that's kind of the nature of bearing ourselves before God, before one another, of stripping off these things that are embarrassing, that aren't good, that aren't right, it will naturally bring some shame. But it sure is great to get that stuff off. I'm sure glad I'm not wearing 18 books anymore. It's freeing to be naked, exposed, to get all of that stuff out in the open and off the name of problems as we move toward a better way. But the good news of the passage is that as hard as that exposing, revealing process is, stripping off the old clothes of the empire, the way of the world, the values of the world, we actually don't have to stay naked for long. Because we actually get to put on new clothes. We get to put on new values. Paul invites us to clothe ourselves with all sorts of beauty and goodness, things that are beautiful we want to wear, we want to put on, we want to clothe ourselves with. As Walsh and Keyes might say, we are invited to drape ourselves, surround ourselves, present ourselves with, and embody the character traits of compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, patience, forgiveness, and love. So we're invited to strip off the world's way of violence, and then to clothe ourselves with compassion that embraces the world with a shared it's cursed. Gentleness is cursed by the empire, but it's actually blessed by Jesus. We are invited to strip off the arrogance of success and domination, where I want to be first and best. I want to conquer anyone else, and I want to be at the top of the ladder. And we clothe ourselves with humility. We allow ourselves to be people who recognize that all of life is a gift. And then we properly align ourselves under the good and gracious rule and reign of King Jesus, who is the one true provider of all things that we have. We are called to strip off the world's demand of immediate gratification and instant results and clothe ourselves with patience. It doesn't have to happen in a second. We can wait. There's all the time that we need. We will be okay. We declare boldly and publicly, as Walsh and Kingsman say, that we are here for the long haul. We measure time in terms of eternity, and our hope is for the restoration of all of creation. And since we know who finally accomplishes such a restoration, we can afford to be patient, waiting. We don't have to rush. It's okay, because we know the one who holds all time in the palm of his hands. And most importantly, Christ has, in a world of revenge and retaliation, we're always looking to get back at that person wrong. I got to get that person. I got to step on that person. I got to get them back for what they did to me. We're called to clothe ourselves with forgiveness. Christ has forgiven us. And we've been freed from the empire, so we drape ourselves, we surround ourselves, we clothe ourselves with forgiveness, allowing mercy and grace to be the very center of our being. We want forgiveness to be the root of everything that we are and everything that we do. Now, I realize it's 11:30, and it's time to end the service. But this is a pretty practical section of Scripture, right? We're not talking about theoretical ideas. We're not talking about abstract ideas. These are really, really practical things that we're talking about. And I think that they deserve some time and attention. So at this point, I'll kind of just take a step away to say, I hope moving forward in the day, in the week, that you will take some time. Wherever that is for you, maybe it's night, maybe it's morning, maybe it's at your home, once you get to work, I don't know, maybe it's taking your dog for a walk and you have your Bible out open. I would invite you to kind of look back through this text, kind of look back through these lists, and to do some thinking, to do some meditating, to do some praying, some journaling, however you reflect best. I invite that process this week. Because I know for me, as I've been preparing, as this stuff has been kind of marinating in this stuff for the last couple weeks, it's worked on me. And it's jabbing me in places that they don't feel good. And I'm not comfortable with it. And I would hope that you would allow yourself into that process as well. What kind of thing stands out in the things that you should not do, that, man, I do that way too often, and I need to rid myself of that. I need to put that to death. I need to strip that piece of imperial clothing from my life. I need to get rid of that thing. And from the second set of things, what kind of things do you need to put on? What do you need to clothe yourself with? Or, man, I'm not compassionate enough. I'm not a very gentle person. Or I have zero patience, and I need to work on that as a spiritual discipline. I would invite you strongly to do that throughout the semester. Now, I'm going to end the way that Paul ends. He ends this section with a line here in verse 17, that I think is a perfect way of ending. He says, in verse 14, and over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect union. He says that the final thing that you clothe yourself with is love. He invites the Colossian church to clothe themselves with love. And I'm So in a world of political smear campaigns and nuclear warheads and spammers taking advantage of poor, unsuspecting victims, all sorts of unlovely kind of behavior that saturates our culture, we are invited to clothe ourselves with love and allow that to be the most important piece of clothing that we have. It perfectly completes the ensemble of the kingdom. It's the finishing touch of everything else that we've been putting on, all the clothes that we've been putting on. Love becomes the final touch. It's the thing that brings all things together in unity. It's the most important piece of our Jesus clothing that we wear. So let's be people who strip off all of the harmful, broken, shameful, stained clothes of the world and clothe ourselves with the clothing of Jesus. With compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, forgiveness, and love. Let's pray. God, thank you so much that you have freed us, that we are not bound by the kingdom, that you have disrobed the empire and laid them bare in their nakedness and shame. And I, for the life of me, can't figure out why I keep going back and forth. I can't for the life of me figure out why we far too often put those clothes back on, or we wear those things that we have no business wearing. So help us to start to strip off the clothing of the world, to rid ourselves of all the ways in which the world tries to sneak its way into our lives, to put to death all the ways in which the empire is trying to kill us, and then to put on the new, beautiful clothes of the kingdom. Help us to do that. Give us the courage to actually sit down and think, to process, to pray about the ways in which our lives aren't measuring up to the way that you intended us to live, and the ways in which we can put some things aside and put some new things on. Give us the courage to do that. In Jesus' name, amen.